So what's left is one example here. So this is example three. In this example, we're going to make use of that moral equivalent failure criterion. So we're going to make use of this moral equivalent failure criterion. This is the effective stress version. Basically, to predict the shear stress at failure or to predict the shear strength on any given plane. If you look at this moral equivalent failure criterion, if you know these two strength parameters, typically you conduct either field or lab tests to get these two strength parameters. If you know these two, then you can calculate the shear strength on any plane by basically knowing the normal stress on that plane. For this example here, there are two parts to this example. For part A, we're going to calculate the drained shear strength. So this is basically means we're going to use the effective stress parameters C prime and phi prime to calculate shear strength. And we're going to calculate the shear strength on this horizontal plane AA. So that's this plane here. So given more coulomb failure criterion, if you want to calculate the shear strength on this plane, we need to know first these two strength parameters, which are given. And second, the normal stress on this plane. And for this horizontal plane, the normal stress will be the vertical effective stress on this plane. So that's basically sigma n on this plane. And we're going to write it in effective stress form. So this is basically, for this horizontal plane, that normal stress on that plane is your vertical effective stress. In chapter 9, we talked about how to calculate this vertical effective stress. Okay. So part A, so the key is to find this sigma n prime, or simply sigma prime. So let's use sigma prime to be consistent. So the vertical or the normal stress. So the normal stress on this AA plane is basically the vertical effective stress on that plane. So sigma prime is a vertical effective stress. And again, something we discussed in chapter 9. So that's the effective stress calculation. We have a freshwater lake. We know that doesn't contribute to effective stress. So we only need to focus on this 15 feet of clay, which is saturated. So we have, let's say 15 feet of saturated clay. This is the buoyant unit weight, gamma B or gamma prime. If you plug in numbers, so this is 15 times 110 minus 62.4. So this value is 714 PSF, pound per square foot. So that's a normal effective stress on plane AA. And then the shear stress at failure, which by definition is the shear strength, is using moral coulomb failure criterion, C prime plus sigma prime tangent of phi prime. And C prime and phi prime are given. So again, you have these strength parameters. So that's 400 plus 714 times tangent of 26. And you get 748.2. So it's about 748. Pound per square foot. So that is the shear strength on horizontal plane AA. Again, we're using moral coulomb failure criteria. So that's part A. And then for part B, this part asks for the drain shear strength again on the same plane after water level drops by 20 feet. So if you look at the setup here, if water level drops by 20 feet, the water table is going to move to this, basically the lake bottom now. Okay. That's part B, water table. If you recall what we did in chapter 9, if the water table changes above ground surface, that does nothing to the effective stress in the soil. Okay, so the effective stress actually does not change in this case. So sigma prime is still the same as part A. So again, changing water table above ground surface does not affect the effective stress in the soil. Okay, so that's again 714. Which means the strain, the shear strength, tau F, stays the same as well. Okay. So same as part one, 748 PSF. So this example basically shows how do you use more coolant failure criterion, that function there, to calculate the shear strength on any given plane. So the key again is to calculate the normal stress on that plane. And if you know the normal stress on that plane, along with the shear strength parameters, then you can predict the shear strength on that plane.